Well, the graphics are like overwhelmingly kind of gorgeous.
Well, the graphics were, it was a priority to make it entertaining on some levels and to make it a movie. What got me excited by this film was, I think, I read Eric Schlosser's book in 2002 and thought, wow, there's a whole world here I hadn't thought about. That's pretty interesting. And actually had thought about doing a film based on Fast Food Nation for a long period of time. And as time went on, though, and we got funding in around 2000, the end of 2006 to go do a film on Fast Food Nation.
So this is after the feature film had already been made?
Yeah, they were just finishing the feature film. But what actually discouraged, what made me think I had to sort of morph, because it still is based on Fast Food Nation on a lot of levels, but what made me morph it is that everyone would come up and say, well, wasn't that already made? Wasn't Super Size Me, the documentary on Fast Food Nation? And, Super Size Me, which was very entertaining, but it's about how fast food is bad for you.
Right.
Eric's book is about how the system became industrialized. And then Michael Pollan's book, Omnivore, was about the whole supermarket becoming industrialized. And that became what our film was about, though it ended up finding new things to be about as we kept shooting, too.
So were you just politically interested, and that drove you to documentary, or did documentary drive you to a subject that happened to be political? And
well, I don't look to make sort of social action films. I think of myself more as a filmmaker than a person who's looking to deal with just issues. I like to have social relevance in the films, but in a funny way, Food Inc. was very much a big social issue film, and it was a challenge for that reason. That's why I loved having the animation. I like to have music that went against the grain. You know, from the opening credits, it sounds like a sort of a fairy tale horror film. I like to make personal films. I like to make, you know, humorous films. I like to make emotional films. Dealing with so much information is a humongous challenge. I'm not sure I'd want to go jump in and do that one again.
So did you dive in by looking at all the other stuff that kind of floating around these subjects, or was it not really happening when you started working on this?
Well, there's been, you know, what's really interesting is that this is a movement. Eric Schlosser wrote his book in 2001. There was nothing going on in this world, particularly at that particular moment. And 4 or 5 years later, I'm thinking, I don't want to do a film on fast food. Everyone knows it's bad. No one had thought about fast food up until then. And 5 years later, we all know fast food's bad. And now, all of a sudden, we're conscious that all food has become industrialized, and we're starting to think about it. So this has fallen into a much bigger movement. We're part of something that's just keeps expanding incredibly rapidly. I've been reading some of the books. You know, I was reading some of the books. I was reading some of, you know, and Michael Pollan's book, Omnivore, obviously changed where I was going, and had a great influence.
Did you change a lot as you were in pre-production, or the really working through what you were going to shoot?
We were changing constantly. I mean, to the point where, you know, I thought we were going to have a dialogue with all the industrial filmmakers. And I thought they would be part of it, and no one would talk to us, or almost no one. And then we were basically finished with the film, and we got a call from Walmart saying they'd like to be in it. And I'm going, oh my gosh, what do we do now?
That's interesting.
Yeah, it was really interesting, because I had no idea how they were going to fit into the film. But felt a certain obligation that we were, you know, saying it's what a crime that these industrial food producers won't talk, and then when you get a call from one of the biggest, I felt a certain obligation to try to figure out how to put them in.
So was that challenging for you to navigate morally, or did you feel like you were being seduced at the same time you were trying to get what you needed out of them?
That's a good question. I didn't know how we were going to use Walmart in the film. We can think of Walmart in a number of negative ways, and they're certainly as responsible for the industrialization of this food system as any company, certainly as much as McDonald's. At the same time, So I had no idea what we were going to do.
Right.
We showed up and they made an announcement that they were no longer going to buy milk with RBST, which is a growth hormone that's given to cattle to produce more milk. And they were going to take it out because consumers had said they don't want it anymore.
Mm.
And when I heard that, I thought, you know, it's really interesting to show the power of the consumer. So rather than tackling Walmart for the many possible things we could have talked about, which I think are well known, I thought that this was a more interesting way of going.
Had you already done Storybrooke? Is it Storybrooke? Am I saying
no,
it right?
They had never, no one knew about this.
But I mean, so you went and talked to them about their business?
We were going to talk about, they flew, we were all meeting in New Hampshire. It took them a whole day, you know, getting from Bentonville was not an easy thing for them, and getting from LA to, you know, where we were going was not easy for us. We had no idea what they were going to say, and we had no idea how we were going to use them.
But the whole yogurt story.
Well, the Stonyfield, that was different.
That's what it is, not Storybrooke.
Yeah.
I knew I had it wrong.
Sorry,
this is why the brand is going so badly.
Oh, I thought you said, did the story break? I'm
sorry. No, I meant Stonyfield.
Well, Stonyfield was...
You can tell I don't buy yogurt.
Yeah. Well, they don't, they're not as big on the West Coast as the East Coast, so... Stonyfield was, you know, it's an interesting story, and I think...
But were you in with them before?
Yes, we
Walmart?
Were. I was in with Stonyfield from the beginning.
Because his story also goes to Walmart. And
well, it's Gary had the most controversial statement. I mean, another $1 million sale to Walmart will help save the world.
Yeah.
And you know, from my, you know, I thought, wow, that's a complicated sentence, and it conjures up a lot of, you know, it makes you stop and think. It's a surprising piece, and I thought. You know, one of the things you want to do in a film is make people think about a food system, and not, you know, not make a film where the 2 or 3 or 4% of the population that's eating perfect food comes up and slaps you on the back and says, "Isn't this wonderful?"
Right.
This film was made for people who go to the supermarket every day and don't think about food, and I'm thrilled to say we're reaching them.
But your timing was kind of brilliant. I mean, your timing kind of worked out to be. Because he is kind of the cutting edge, the whole story of organics now becoming a marketing tool.
Yeah,
you know, is you guys kind of hit that moment?
Oh, I planned that. I thought, okay, let's start in 2005, and we'll break
just around
2009,
right,
and it's all going to go our way. You know,
but it was fascinating.
That's what you have to do as a filmmaker. You have to think 4 or 5 years out and see where it's going to go.
But I think that's where the difference between a film that does become as popular as Food Inc. has already become. Forget about whether you win the Oscar. But the, you know, I think the audience for the movie, all those timing things, as well as good filmmaking, kind of have to come together.
Something exploded that is beyond my imagination. It's been incredible. I mean, we just were on Oprah, and we were the number one selling DVD on Amazon, and that's shocking. You know, I mean, it speaks to the Oprah bounce.
Yes,
but. You know, I didn't know were people going to go to the theater to see Food Inc. You know, were people going to go buy it? That was, you know, you don't know until it happens. And then to see that happen, it show that we're playing into something that is really snowballing.
Yeah.
And it's been pretty wild to watch.
Now, the process for you in terms of getting it in front of people, you made the film with private money, I guess.
Well, we made the film with Participant Media.
Oh, yes.
And with River Road.
So they were gung-ho, but it's still not, you don't have a studio built into it.
We didn't have a studio built into it, but we had Participant who was behind the film from day one.
Right.
And they wanted to raise they wanted to get half of the money from outside.
Right.
But they said, we're going to find that money and we're going to make this movie. Mm-hmm. So that part was great.
So when you had the movie done, what was the process of getting to distribution?
Yeah, we finished the film in about right before the Toronto. Well, actually, we were finishing right at the Toronto Festival, and we'd screened for a number of people. People seemed to be interested, though.
Yeah.
There were also those, you know, we didn't know where it was going.
Right.
And we screened in Toronto, and all of a sudden, at the end of the film. People seem to be into it, but at the end of the film, we have the list of to-dos, and then we have credits. People stood for about 5 minutes, and it was like goosebumps. It was like, hey, I guess they don't hate it, you know. But it was really well received. And then we mm-hmm. went to Berlin, and we played in a theater that was about 1,600 people. And it was so it was very.
And did it play differently, or was it the same?
It was a little different. I mean, Toronto was. We had never shown it to anyone, so Toronto right. was amazing. Berlin was amazing because mm-hmm. it was again really well received. It's. The audiences are not quite as bouncy, you know, they didn't yeah. stand, but it was...
You mean they're German? Were,
but they were totally into it, yeah. and we packed every screening, mm-hmm. So that was pretty amazing. So
you went to the 5 months, and at that point you still didn't have a theatrical?
No, we got distribution after Toronto.
Right after Toronto,
So
okay.
Magnolia came in right after Toronto, uh-huh. And they were with us in Berlin.
And were you sure when you made the deal originally that how much of a theatrical and how much of a VOD and DVD release it would be, or how that would balance out?
Were we sure? I mean, you know.
Well, I mean, I'm just curious. I mean, ultimately, obviously, everybody is trying to figure out exactly what the system is.
Yeah.
This film has done very well in theatrical.
Yeah, we're one of the top 20 films. I mean,
yeah.
But were we sure? We weren't sure of, you know, you're not sure of,
right.
You know.
But they offered, did they come to you saying, we're going to do a theatrical, that's where
important to us? Oh, that was absolute. Yes, they were absolutely releasing theatrical. Mm-hmm. We were going, opening in 3 theaters, and then we were going to go wide. But what did wide mean? You
right.
know, that becomes, it's obviously dependent on how it does. And we opened up and we broke house records at the Film Forum in New York. And mm-hmm. We started to do well, and we... What I think was really propelling it mm-hmm. was that we were starting to, the press was really into covering it. We got great reviews, which was wonderful.
Yeah.
But we were also on the op-ed pages, and we were also in the food sections, mm-hmm. And we were in different sections of newspapers. And as I say, we were part of this exploding food right. movement, where. People just were becoming more and more interested in this subject, which, by the way, I had no idea about our timing, just to get back to timing.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we finished right before the financial crisis. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, who is going to care about the high cost of low-cost food if you can't afford it?
Right.
You know, I'm thinking, our timing's horrible. We should have come out right away. So just to show you my, hindsight, I thought we were, my insight rather, yeah. I thought we were making a mistake. I thought we should have come out sooner. But I think our timing turned out to be perfect because Obama becomes president, healthcare becomes the big issue. And the fact is you can't really have a healthcare program in this country without fixing the food system.
One is the movie says repeatedly, there continue to be these stories in the news every month, every yeah. 3 weeks about this health scare and this, yeah. you know,
but I think that's
problem.
A small part of it. You know, I think that the health scares are going to continue to be there. Mm-hmm. You know, that's going to happen. And Eric Schlosser said, September's coming. There'll be a lot of, what? But it's, what about the financial crisis? We had, banks and hedge funds saying, we can do this better than the government. You know, right. we don't need regulations. And we fell off a cliff, and they almost brought the whole world down with them because of their short-term greed. Well, I think there's similarities with the food world mm-hmm. That go beyond health scares. I'm talking yeah. about a total collapse of a system. And, these companies are saying they don't need government regulation. Well, and people, they're libertarians like Joel, our farmer, who's mm-hmm. scared of government. But I'm scared of corporations that have such tremendous amount of power. There's something, I think they need certain regulations.
Well, Food Inc. is kind of a perfect double feature with The Informant
right.
as well. It's about the yeah. ADM yeah. stuff, and it's a true story, even though it's played for comedy by Soderbergh. But I was watching last night and remembering all the corn from Informant. They right. kind of matched together.
They were both participant, but
yes.
But I think, in a funny way, I think it's Michael Clayton becomes the perfect double
yeah.
bill. That's why.
Well, you have to, paying attention is challenging.
That's why you were frisked before you came in here.
There's somebody watching us outside right now. They're putting a bomb underneath the car.
Yeah.
So have you felt...
You joke.
Have you felt a difference? I actually did an interview the other day with a director who has made a very political documentary himself recently, and it was the first time I ever felt like somebody could come up and shoot the person I was interviewing. We were interviewing in a public place, so it was like, I've never felt like in a Q&A session, like somebody with a gun might be sitting out there lurking.
I don't want to even go there.
A little scary. Have you been scared? Have you had moments where you're feeling intimidated?
I don't want to go there.
You don't want to go there. You, now you're like one of the farmers in your movie.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the fact is, there are laws in this country, veggie libel laws that make it against the law in certain states to endanger the profits of a food product. Food products have more rights than individuals.
It is one of the crazy, that was one of the craziest things I think in the movie for me. I mean, a lot of shocking things in the movie, but veggie law, and where did it, how did it become called the veggie laws?
It's part of an Orwellian world that we have. There are veggie libel laws, or in the same way that when we went, you know, to a hearing on whether we should label cloned meat, and the representative said, I don't think it's in the consumer's interest to give them this kind of information. You know, if you live in a free country with a free market, and yet we're being told that we shouldn't have information, something's wrong.
Well, it's always interesting because people really so much don't want to know anyway, and yet they're so afraid that people will know. It's an interesting dichotomy.
Well, I think as people become conscious that this system is making us sick,
well, that
they're going to start to want to know more.
Yeah,
and it's happening really quickly. You know, I went out with Eric Schlosser's editor from Rolling Stone. That's how this whole thing started. Huh. Was an editor from Rolling Stone came up. Will Dana came up with an idea about doing an article about a particular city. Mm-hmm. And he was going to put all his reporters on it, and it didn't quite pan out. Mm-hmm. But he realized in the city that there were these strips outside of the town with these fast food restaurants, and he thought that, you know, that were, it was growing rapidly, and he thought that was such an interesting phenomena. That was in 1997, and he mentioned it to Eric, who wasn't sure it was going to be a good story or not, and they came up with the idea. So 13 years ago, there was a like notion, hey, strip malls are growing with fast food restaurants. So think how quickly our world has changed. And 6-7 years ago, I didn't even want to do fast food because I thought everyone knew it was bad. And now I think people are going to start to look at the supermarket differently.
Well, the fact that you're noticing it is, I think, the biggest change.
Well, that's the thing I think we hope for most, is that people start to notice it. I'm getting asked to speak on college campuses, and they're kids are coming up, they're getting their colleges to source locally for their cafeterias. And, you know, for me, you travel around the country, the National School Lunch Program, whenever you saw something horrible, the Downer Cow or whatever, I won't even go into the things we saw, when I asked where it was going, it was the National School Lunch Program. It was terrifying.
Which makes you a kindred spirit with the Cove, I guess.
Yeah.
Serving dolphin meat to innocent children.
Right.
Who don't know any different.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's funny because we were having a conversation the other day about Valencia, which is a town here in near outside of L.A. that was built really for families.
Yeah.
That was the whole very designed place before it had to expand. And there's literally no family, you know, individually owned restaurants.
Right.
It's all chain stuff. And I guess chain stuff, even though it's not fast food necessarily, is pretty much eating out of the same trough.
It was on the talk circuit, and I met David Kessler, who was appointed by George H. Bush to become head of the FDA. And he just wrote a book called The End of Overeating, and he talks about the massive amounts of sugar, salt, and fat that are being pumped into all of these chain restaurants and the processed food, and how we have to keep upping the ante to keep people more and more excited by this food, and how this is like causing incredible health crises. And it's really no different than nicotine. It's the same thing. It's just getting people addicted to this food. And kids, when you start to eat that, you can't go back and eat a strawberry or a carrot because it has no flavor anymore. And it ruins us.
So the challenge of eating this stuff and doing it on a budget, even if you're not poor, you know, the whole sequence where you go with the family to the market and they're trying to buy broccoli and it's so expensive. Yeah. But just going to Whole Foods to buy, you know, fresh vegetables and fruit is overwhelming sometimes.
It's a challenge, but you know, maybe there's a alternative system, a more regional, a more local system that gets away from these big corporations. And I think that's ultimately, as much as it's the food, it's also how this food has become so centralized and so controlled by few who have so much power. So if we can break that down by starting to buy from our local, you know, from our neighbors who are selling us food, neighbors are less likely to sell you bad food because they're going to see you again.
Well, it's the irony also that, you know, size does bring the price down. So you kind of want to see these local farmers get bigger so they can actually, you know, there's some economy of scale. But then, of course, if they get too big, then they cross that line.
Yeah. Well, no, the problem is that it brings the price down, but they're polluting the water, they're polluting the earth, they're making people sick. So they're not paying the real cost.
Yeah.
You know, you got to see the cost.
So have you sensed any real change in your audience since Oprah and since the Amazon thing? I mean, are you reaching the Walmart consumer now, finally?
Well, to begin with, it's always been a broad spectrum, way more than I anticipated. But we have evangelical church groups calling. We have U.S. News and World Report. The Murdochs in England are going to be passing our film out in their newspapers. Oh. So, you know, I don't think good food has ideology. Ultimately, everyone wants to eat food that doesn't make them sick.
Right.
So it's like part of it is making people conscious. Oprah exploded our world, though. Mm-hmm. I spoke to one reporter the other day who said, I was carrying your film around for months. I just couldn't watch it.
Right.
You know, and she said, after Oprah, I decided to watch it. And she was wishing me luck. She said, I really hope you win and get to go on the Academy Award and give a speech. And she said, you know, you got to tell people and, you know, use that soapbox and light yourself on fire, do something, you know. I said, well, I don't quite want to go that far, but.
Well, I mean, are you prepared to proselytize? I mean, is that part of your makeup, or is this is the work? Please watch it, please watch it, please watch it.
And well, I don't, you know, and the work itself doesn't proselytize.
No.
I mean, all we try to do is to say, as Oprah says, think for yourself, you know, make your own decisions.
Well, ADM might disagree, or, you know.
Well, they do.
EPI or whatever.
I've just heard today that Monsanto called and is trying to stop us from going on television, even though they also made an announcement saying they're sorry they weren't in the film. Hugh Grant, the head of the company, made an announcement. So on one hand, they're sorry they're not in the film, but they would still like to try to stop it from being
seen. Stop it by pressuring the studios not to...
The TV stations. And so I think that's a mistake. I think they should be encouraging this conversation about food.
And do you... I guess in the form of this film, it would make sense they would have that kind of juice, no?
Well, I think, as I said to them when we spoke after they screened the film, that, you know, you could present yourself as someone who can feed the world. You know, you could have your own arguments.
Right.
And it's a shame you wouldn't be willing to present them in the film. And
so will they be a DVD extra in the...
Well, no, I have nothing to show. There's nothing. They never talked.
So how did you show them the film? Am I getting you in trouble?
Yeah, but it's an off-the-record situation. So.
Okay. So there was a secret screening. Is that, I mean, it's...
I have screened for numbers of these companies that refuse to talk. And now I think what's happened is they're beginning to realize that their consumers are really interested in this subject. And they can't just laugh at us. They can't just say, you know, this is silly. And they have to start to engage. So the same people that refuse to talk, I think, are now much more interested in becoming part of the conversation.
Well, doesn't the Walmart thing kind of show that you can market, if you're a good marketer and you're a smart marketer, you can come up with the right angle for anything?
Yeah, but I think...
I mean, they're doing the right thing, but they're doing it for commercial reasons.
Well, you know what? I actually believe, maybe I got sold a bill of goods, but I actually believe that Walmart believes in sustainability. Mm-hmm. As I say, I could knock Walmart for numbers of reasons, one of them being that they helped industrialize the system. But I also think they're going to improve the system in terms of sustainability more than anything, and more than anyone or any company, and that they absolutely, perhaps they got into it because they wanted to build a firewall and they were being attacked for everything.
Right.
But at some point, I actually believe that they've grown to believe, which is interesting. So, you know, I think that we have to be open to corporations that we might think of as, you know, not part of the solution, becoming part of the solution. You know, it's not going to be made up just by the Joel Saladins of the world. And,
right.
And maybe I still don't want to go buy my organic milk from Walmart because it might not be the organic that I'm interested in.
Right.
But I think it's better that it's there than it's not there. So I don't want to just say that they were doing it for marketing. I think they were doing it for more than that reason.
And is there a danger ultimately for, you know, the phrase organic to become too well handled by too many people who don't necessarily have the best interest at heart?
I think organic is, you know, ultimately the standards of organic have been way watered down. They're way too low.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people say, can you believe something when it says organic? The answer is yes, you can believe it. But is it good enough? No,
right.
I don't think it is. I think we should have stricter standards. But I also think there's really good food that's not organic, that's selling at local farmers markets that are, it's hard for farmers to get certified organic, and
right.
they don't bother. And that food happens to be great. So I like local food just as much as organic food, frankly.
Well, there's so many things that really don't need to be organic to be okay.
Yeah.
I mean, by the standards of that, it seems like sometimes it gets a little silly.
And some of the food might be better because, as I say, it's difficult for small farmers. And we need more small farmers, but I'm talking like a food expert. I'm not a food expert. I'm a filmmaker, you know. So it becomes a strange.
Does it? I mean, has it been an odd journey in that way?
It's a really strange journey, because I feel like I've fallen through a rabbit's hole into a, you know.
Well, Morgan Spurlock certainly wasn't an expert in fast food or vomiting.
Right.
But you know.
Well, he.
Getting you in trouble again, am I?
No. I was just thinking that his wife wouldn't have sex with him until he stopped eating fast food. So,
but it's an interesting thing. I mean, it's like these public events become bigger than us, I guess.
Something. So on that level, it's been really an incredible trip, you know, traveling with Food Inc. and seeing it explode in ways you can only dream of, but mm-hmm. at the same time, it's a shock and it's a surprise, and it has these repercussions. It takes you to places you never expected to be going to.
So do you push away from this in your next film? Is that you're finding something completely different?
I tend to really like to make changes when you go make films, you know, maybe to make a thoroughly personal film that might have a sort of a social underbelly, but to do it in a very personal way, or to come at it in a very different way, I think would be of interest, as opposed to, you know, I'm going to make another social action doc that's going to change the world.
Might you executive produce Food Inc. 2 and Food Inc. 3? I mean, it seems like you could really do, it almost seems like it's time for a series or a series of 10 films for HBO or something, continuing this discussion. Because as good as the movie is, it's, you know, it's the beginning of the conversation almost.
Yeah. Though, it was funny because when we were doing our contracts, my lawyer came back and said, well, do you want to own the series rights?
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking, I don't want to franchise Food Inc. I'm making a film about the evils of franchising, you know. So do we want to own the franchise rights? I thought that was a funny thing. And I guess I still feel... that I'm not ready to go off and do Food Inc. 2, Food Inc. 3. So, though there are many fascinating stories. I just came back speaking in Detroit. This really interests me, and I'd be curious to follow through on this. There's not a supermarket in the whole city of Detroit.
Huh.
It's what we call a food desert.
Wow.
And there are food deserts all over the United States. Baldwin Park is a food desert, which is what, 30 minutes from here. They don't have a supermarket in what looks like a pretty middle-class world. There are large parts of inner cities throughout the United States without supermarkets. There are large parts of rural America without supermarkets. Detroit, which is hit the hardest of any city, basically they have convenience stores with processed junky food. And they've started growing their own produce in abandoned lots, and 8% of the city's produce is now grown inside Detroit, which is pretty wild. So maybe the answer to our food system is going to come out of Detroit.
What's always interesting to me, I mean, I think documentary in the last number of years, as it's become more accessible form for people, they become cheaper to make, I guess, for a lot of people. You know, you're seeing these combinations of films that kind of lead to a whole. I mean, your film connects to The Garden in some ways from last year, and it, as I say, it connects to, you know, other films for next year. And it's it has an ecological system almost of its own now.
Right.
Where this conversation becomes all those things. And I'm sure there's a young filmmaker who saw Food Inc. who's out there saying, I want to tell, you know, my piece of the story.
I'm getting emails every day with people, young filmmakers, talking about their stories. And I wish I had more time to be more helpful, but hopefully I will be after the Academy.
Have you picked out your tuxedo yet?
Yeah, I have an organic tuxedo.
Ah, made of hemp or?
No, I'm made of organic wool. And I think it'll be great.
So when you go down and you talk to people on the lawn, Joan Rivers, you'll be able to?
Yeah, I'll show off my wool and Loom State tuxedo. So.
And vegan shoes or what are you?
Well, I haven't figured out the shoes yet. Hopefully I'll have time. I'm running like crazy up until then. So hopefully I'll have shoes.
working on Food Inc. still or on other things?
Going to speak about food and doing Food Inc. and working on other things.
Is there a point where you go, okay, I'm done with Food Inc. I'm not going to take another speaking engagement. I'm off this boat for a while.
It's coming.
This is an experience, besides all the good things that have come of it, the immersiveness of this experience, not what you expected when you got into
it. It's shocking. It's exhausting. It's shocking, but it's wonderful. Uh-huh. It's, you know, you have to keep reminding yourself this is what you dreamed of. But it's physically grueling. We're going, you know, airplane after airplane all over the country, all over the world. Everyone seems, you know, it's a film about the U.S., but it's really a film about the entire world. It's a film not only about food, it's about economics, and it's about the race to the bottom.
Yeah.
And corporations ultimately taking on a life of their own where profit means everything. And it comes at the expense of the earth and the consumers. So there are a lot of people who want to talk about it.
Well, the rest of the world is almost like an alarm system for us. I mean, when you hear about, you know, mad cow disease and all that, which hasn't really affected the United States so much, but it's kind of is a wake-up call that it can get here.
Yeah, well, I mean,
things like it.
In England, they were saying, wait a second, your food system's far worse than ours. Why should we be worried? It's not about us. It's about you.
Right.
And they're very conscious of GMOs in England. We're not conscious of them. And they're saying, we don't have them. We're much better than you. Well, they do have them. They just don't know about it because it's coming in the food for the animals. Or the Smithfield pork plant that you see in Food Inc., there's one in Romania. So that cheap food is coming to a supermarket to people in England. It's coming to supermarkets in Asia.
Yeah.
It's a worldwide system. And soon the food won't even be made in the United States.
We go back to Darwin's nightmare a few years ago. And farming out that Tanzania and sending it to England.
Yeah, and probably, you know, what were the fish eating?
Yeah.
Probably the people.
That's a heartwarming way to wrap up an interview.
On that note, I want to wish you luck.
So do you have a speech ready?
No, but I'm thinking about it.
Okay, but you're not going to set yourself on fire.
What's that?
If you win, you're not going to set yourself on fire.
I'll go just shy of setting myself on fire. So.
Maybe just a little bit.
Right. I'll bring my Bic lighter, but you know.
Just make sure it's not rare. It's got to be medium well at least. Otherwise, you're going to die.
Hopefully, the organic tux is, you know, fireproof.